Thanks to YouTube shutting down its Rewind for good, there are no fun memes or spoofs to use to introduce the much better Paleo Rewind this year. So without further ado, I'm Destin of Edge, and welcome to Paleo Rewind 2021. Every year, hundreds of amazing discoveries are made. Since my main interest involves the lives of long-dead animals, I bring together a group of other creators to talk about the most interesting and important of them. This is Paleo Rewind. This year I've done something a lot more ambitious than last year. Doubled the number of participants. Instead of 12 people covering a month each, there are 24 people. Each month has two creators making a video. Each of their sections will release in the 12 days leading up to the 1st of January. On that day, I will release a compilation of everyone's segments here on the Edge channel. This year, those involved include the Curious Archive for the first half of January and Paleo Analysis for the second, to be released on the 20th. Myself and Dylan of Paleo Archive for February on the 21st. Henry the Paleoguy and Omega Studios for March on the 22nd. The Dinosaurs Will Always Be Awesome podcast and Steven from Your Dinosaurs Are Wrong for April on the 23rd. Spino Dude Reviews and me again for May on the 24th. Adasaur and Keenan Taylor for June on the 25th. Raptor Chatter and the Through Time and Clades podcast for July on the 26th. Dr. Polaris and Past Eons Productions for August on the 27th. Prehistorica and Spencer of Cretaceous Cast for September on the 28th. Ben from Benji Thomas and Dino Diego for October on the 29th. Dane Pavitt and The Budget Museum for November on the 30th. And finally, Northo 2 and Biotaverse for December on the 31st.
Did you know that just this year, paleontologists have discovered new insights into the behavior and appearance of Spinosaurus, the biomechanics of megalodon teeth, and the strangest early life forms of the Cambrian explosion? New revelations are occurring all the time regarding Earth's distant past, yet these incredible findings often go unnoticed by the general public. So, this year, I'm taking part in Paleo Rewind, a breakdown of some of the most important revelations in the field of paleontology from the past year. All sorts of other creators you might already be subscribed to are also participating. In this video, I'll kick the rewind off by covering findings from the first half of January, but be sure to check out everyone else's entries too, and the final 2021 compilation video that will be uploaded on Edge's channel. Now let's get started. Beginning in early January 2021, we have new findings on the potential ecology and feeding behavior of the famous theropod Spinosaurus. The Spinosaurus is a dinosaur that has long gripped popular culture in its elongated jaws, thanks in part to its appearance in the Jurassic Park franchise. But the common conception I grew up with of the Spinosaurus as a bigger, heavier T-Rex analog isn't quite accurate. Indeed, the Spinosaurus has been the subject of considerable recent debate regarding its biology and ecology, as it might have been highly unique from other carnivorous theropods due to its semi-aquatic or perhaps highly aquatic lifestyle. A paper published January 7th by Dr. David Hone and Dr. Thomas Holtz weighs the likelihood of Spinosaurus being a wading animal that fed on fish near the shorelines and in shallow water, or a specialized aquatic pursuit predator. Their studies were quite complex, but to simplify, based on the anatomy of the fossils we have and related ecological data, the wading model is more supported than the highly aquatic one. Still, the authors note that Spinosaurus almost certainly fed primarily from the water and may have swum, which alone might have made it incredibly distinct from most other large theropods. Our next discovery exposes new revelations regarding the history of a highly adapted group of aquatic predators. Sharks. For hundreds of millions of years, sharks of various sizes have been patrolling Earth's oceans, and throughout the Cenozoic, an extinct family known as megatooth sharks started to trend towards gigantism, a trend that culminated in the well-known megalodon, the largest macropredatory shark to ever exist. This species exceeded lengths of up to 15 meters, or 50 feet, and likely weighed more than 50 tons. But a mystery has long surrounded the megalodon regarding the nature of their teeth. Compared to the teeth of earlier megatooth sharks, megalodon teeth consistently had greater crown width, for reasons that aren't entirely clear. Recently, Dr. Antonio Bayel and Dr. Humberto Ferron ran a series of experiments testing the biomechanics of earlier megatooth shark teeth compared to the megalodon, and the results were quite surprising. It seems stress distribution patterns were remarkably similar across all models, meaning that the teeth of megalodons, while obviously deadly, weren't any better adapted than the teeth of other sharks in their family. It seems that megalodon teeth shifted in shape as a byproduct of their gigantism, instead of a specific evolutionary advantage. Still, it wouldn't have been fun to get bitten by one. Winding back the clock by half a billion years, we reached the Cambrian explosion, a metaphorical eruption in the diversity of early life forms, which, as of January 2021, we have new information on. You might already know that the Cambrian explosion gave rise to countless bizarre life forms, many of which seem more like alien life than something from Earth's past. From the surreal Opabinia, which might have possessed a flexible trunk that makes it look almost like a living cartoon, to the Hallucigenia, an animal so dreamlike its name comes from the word hallucination, it's a fascinating early milestone in Earth's biodiversity. In a recent examination by Dr. A.J. Shore and Dr. R.A. Wood unveils a new addition to this pantheon of oddities. Through the analysis of some exceptionally well-preserved fossils, researchers were able to distinguish a life form that possessed a cup-shaped skeleton, with six radially arranged lobes surrounding what was likely its mouth. A reconstruction of this life form shows it was a highly unique form of animal, and perhaps a foundational member of the Lophotrochozoan clade, a group that today includes various types of cephalopods and mollusks. Sometimes seemingly small discoveries in the realm of paleontology can lead to major revelations. One article from January 6 shows a curious potential relationship between herbivorous dinosaurs and the very plants that they ate. A new examination of fossilized gut contents by Dr. George Perry suggests plant seeds remained intact within the stomachs of plant-eating dinosaurs. Cross-referencing this data with the distances they likely walked, it seems possible that herbivorous dinosaurs disperse plant seeds far and wide via their, well, droppings. Strange though this might sound, some modern plant munchers, like African bush elephants, play a similar role in the, seed dispersal of certain types of plants. In fact, the dispersal of plant seeds within the bodies of animals is so frequent in current ecosystems that plants often modify their fruits and flowers to appeal more to specific species. And since some dinosaurs could consume even more plant matter per day than elephants, it's likely they were highly sought after seed distributors millions of years ago. A strange but fascinating discovery. And our last article covers a whole new taxon of marine predator, with specialized teeth unlike those of any known reptile. This new taxon is a member of the mosasaurids, a group of mid-Cretaceous lizards that became specialized for marine life. This exciting new taxon, called Xenodens calmancharii, lived just before the KPG extinction, and stands out from all other mosasaurids. As reported in the article by Dr. Natalie Bardet and Dr. Nicholas Longrich, this new mosasaurid possessed teeth that were hooked and formed a saw-like blade. The specialized teeth suggest a previously unknown hunting strategy, likely involving a cutting motion to carve pieces out of large prey. Or perhaps these unique teeth were used for scavenging already deceased marine life forms. In either case, these teeth are unique not just among mosasaurids, but all reptiles in general.
So, just doing the back half of January, I still have a ton of stuff to cover, so I'm going to be focusing on the highlights. Let's do a top 5 with possibly one of the most interesting discoveries of the year at the end. To start us off, we have a new caiman-like crocodilian that was identified from Middle Eocene deposits in southwest Texas. Now, going into the late Paleocene and Eocene, the world was warm and humid from pole to pole. This came with an explosion of diversity in the crocodilians. However, this wouldn't last forever, as the diversity of crocodilians would experience a huge bottleneck when the Oligocene began and the global climate started to become cooler and drier. Now, this specimen was found in 2010 in the Devil's Graveyard Formation, but wasn't formally identified as a new species until January of this this year. Most of the maxilla was found, and it was given the name Chinatichampus wilsonorum. It is thought that this species might be the oldest and most basal ancestor of caimans, showing more basal qualities than the already known species Proto-Caiman. That means if this is true, despite this individual living in the Eocene, this species may have been around since the end of the Cretaceous. And now for our second item, we have dinosaur butts.
I wish I was kidding.
So on many different animals today, the urinary, digestive, and reproductive tracts all end in a single opening called the cloaca. This might seem strange, but placental mammals and bony fish are actually the only two groups of vertebrates who don't have this arrangement. So because both birds and reptiles have cloacas, it was always just believed that dinosaurs would. But no fossil evidence was ever found one way or another. Or maybe they just haven't checked. Luckily for all of us, Dr. Jacob Vinther took up the task, re-examining the beautifully preserved specimen of Cetacosaurus that already taught us in 2016 that these early ceratopsids actually had counter shading, like many animals today, probably for camouflage. And now, after closer examination of the hindquarters, who wrote that? The difference in pigment and scale pattern led Dr. Vinther to theorize that the cloaca may have been used as a display. In addition, the lobes visible on either side of the cloaca are thought to have been scent glands. So there's that. Thank you, Dr. Vinther. All jokes aside, though, this is a really big discovery that can give us a valuable bit of insight into both the anatomy and behavior of non-avian dinosaurs. And both of those things are really hard to find in the fossil record. Up next, we have some long-sought-after information about one of the most famous groups of dinosaurs in the world. Tyrannosaur fossils are extremely well-documented, but one thing that has always been historically lacking is fossils from extremely young animals. But a team of paleontologists from Canada and the United States has been closely studying fragmentary fossils that, they believe, could shed some light on this mysterious part of their lives. The fossils include an embryonic jaw with teeth from the Two Medicine Formation believed to belong to a hatchling Despletosaurus, and a perinatal tooth and embryonic claw found at the Horseshoe Canyon Formation believed to be attributed to Albertosaurus. This is the first time anyone has been able to study fossils from tyrannosaurids in this age range, and since tyrannosaur eggs still have never been found, it could provide clues into their nesting habits. One piece of information that came from this study was that apparently tyrannosaur hatchlings don't have the characteristic serrations on their teeth that we normally think of in older individuals. But some features were definitely present. Like on the embryonic Despletosaurus jaw, it may not have had the teeth serrations, but it did have the chin. Also, using these fossils, we can estimate the size that the two Tyrannosaur embryos were and get an idea of how big they would be when they hatch. The Despletosaurus was estimated around 71 centimeters or 2.3 feet long, and the Albertosaurus was around 1.1 meters or 3.6 feet long. For our fourth spot, we have another new species described, a mosasaur from Morocco that scientists have named Xenodens kalmanikari. Now, this wasn't a very large mosasaur, especially compared to the giants like Mosasaurus and Tylosaurus, being compared to the size of a modern porpoise. But what was really interesting about this animal is the teeth. They had knife-like teeth that were packed very tightly together to turn the entire jaw into a perfect solid cutting edge, more similar to certain species of sharks than what you would normally see in mosasaurs. This allowed the animal to potentially feed on prey items that were much larger than themselves, either by scavenging or by tearing off pieces of flesh and then fleeing before being attacked. A helpful adaptation for sure, considering the shores of North Africa were populated by a menagerie of sea monsters like long-necked plesiosaurs, large carnivorous fish, giant sea turtles, and other larger mosasaurs. This gives us one more example of how these incredible animals adapted to fill many different ecological niches as they expanded and replaced a lot of the earlier marine reptiles that were more prominent in the Jurassic and early Cretaceous. And now I have the honor of talking about one of the biggest discoveries made in paleontology this year. Thanks again to Curious Archive for letting me talk about it, since technically this did come out in the first half of January. So if you're a follower of me or any of my colleagues here on YouTube, you've probably heard of this one. The direwolf has been quickly elevated to one of the most well-known and charismatic of Pleistocene megafauna. in part because of its depictions in popular media, as well as the truly impressive amount of fossil evidence that has been uncovered. It has risen to nearly the same level of recognition as the mammoth and smilodon. However, recent DNA analysis has shown that these canids' evolutionary story is far more complicated than previously thought. The new data shows that direwolves actually split off from a common ancestor with North American canids like gray wolves and coyotes between 5 and 6 million years ago. And after studying 46 subfossil specimens, they could find no gene flow between direwolves and gray wolves. So there was no interbreeding ever occurring like we see between wolves and coyotes today. This analysis separates the direwolf so far genetically than what we previously thought that they thought it was appropriate to give the animal a new name, from Canis diurus to Anisaion diurus. Now, what is really astounding about this animal is, despite the concrete genetic evidence that we have, how much these two animals look alike. Now this here is a gray wolf, and this here is a dire wolf. And for this reason, you really can't blame scientists for not coming to this conclusion sooner, especially when you consider what else the genetic evidence showed. For you see, let me move these guys back, what we now understand to be the closest living relative to Anisaion diurus is this little guy. This is the skull of a black-backed jackal, a small African canid that fills a similar role in the ecosystem to what coyotes fill in North America. This is just one of those remarkable examples where the morphological evidence might tell us one thing, because if you look at these two animals, anyone just glancing at them would guess that these two are closely related. But when you look into an animal's genetic code, sometimes you might find something that you never could have expected. Now, if you enjoyed getting a little bit of a closer look at the hardware of some of these creatures, I intend to cover the dire jackal as well as many other prehistoric creatures in future Paleo Catalog videos.
Welcome to February 2021. Many things were discovered in this month, and surprisingly, many things were published in just the first half as well. At first, I didn't find any immediate standouts, but as I dug deeper, I kept finding really interesting things, and couldn't help myself but bring them up. You've hopefully just come from the Curious Archive and Paleo Analysis' videos for January. Don't forget to watch my introduction to know how this Paleo Rewind 2021 thing is going down. Ground sloth chainmail. Ground sloths are some of the weirdest animals around. They had really messed up skulls, walked on the sides of their feet, had short, ultra-muscular tails, and big, wide, bowl-shaped hips that were the widest parts of their bodies. On top of that, many had internal body armor. A new study by a team of Argentinian paleontologists Nestor Toledo, Alberto Boscaini, and Leandro Martin Perez used X-rays to analyze a section of preserved ground sloth hide to figure out the hows and whys of the armor that lay beneath the skin. Osteoderms are lumps of bone that form within the skin. They push through the skin and any large scales lying above the bone. As they grow, the keratin scutes laying atop the skin becomes a cap over the bony core. This is what you find in crocodilians, dinosaurs, lizards, and more, but not quite what is seen in ground sloths. They have balls of bone that remain under the skin with no scales or scutes over top them. This means the bony balls wouldn't have been visible on the outside of the animal. This is partially why the bones beneath the skin of the ground sloths are called dermal ossicles. The team found through the X-rays that this particular ground sloth, belonging to the Mylodontidae family, had ossicles arranged in different patterns. They have different morphologies, sizes, and are organized into rosettes, stars, and rows, or are unorganized or even absent in some areas. This arrangement of dermal ossicles is like what has been seen in other ground sloths where skin is preserved, so that's good news. The team also sliced some of the ossicles into thin microscope slide-ready chips to do a little histology. We love to do a little histology. Histology being the study of the microscopic structures of tissues. It tells you a lot about how bones do be kinda bony. From there, one can infer and confirm possible biological functions for those bony bits. In this instance, the team came up with some hypotheses on why these specific types of ground sloths may have had their bony bits, thanks to slicing and dicing them bony bits. They may have used them for armor, that's the obvious answer. But there's a possibility they were used for regulating the animal's body temperature, which is seen in the armor of armadillos and crocodilians, as well as sexually dimorphic armor so that males could do some wrestling without giving each other big ouchies. New Cambrian Lagerstätte from Africa. Lagerstätte are special rock deposits that preserve most of the soft tissues of organisms and are known from all over the world. Old ones from before the time of land dwellers are exceptionally important, as most animals around during the Cambrian didn't have hard parts that could easily fossilize. These are some of the only ways to get an idea of what kinds of critters preceded the critters with bones. Guess what? A brand new Lagerstätte site has been found and described from Morocco. This one dates to the early Cambrian, and so far a bunch of exceptionally preserved trilobites, some brachiopods, and hyoliths have been described. Many more are yet to be prepared and described, so hopefully we'll get a new picture of the Cambrian from this site. Freshwater trilobites? Trilobites are the most common parts of Paleozoic marine ecosystems. They're everyone's favorite fossil to collect, and are known in the thousands of species. They lasted longer than the dinosaurs, and come in every variation on a roly-poly body plan possible. That being said, they all seem to come from saltwater habitats. No one has ever found incontrovertible proof of trilobites taking on the freshest of fresh waters. That was until a new study by Maria Mangano and friends, which found uncontroversial trace and body fossils of trilobites living in brackish water. True, that ain't fresh water, but it's as close as the fossil record has ever shown. These trilobites therefore had to be tolerant to changes in salinity, as they made use of tide-dominated estuaries. How domeheads grow. Pachycephalosaurs are often overlooked. This is probably because you can count the only good specimens on your hand. The easiest part of their bodies to fossilize were their dome-shaped skulls. But even then, only the hardest part, the dome, survived the fossilization process the best. To that end, there are a good number of pachycephalosaurians known, mostly, if not entirely, from domes. One of those dome taxa is Spherothallus, a small pachycephalosaur known from specimens from New Mexico, Montana, Saskatchewan, and Alberta, Canada. These specimens are pretty much all domes, but enough of those domes have been preserved to not only differentiate them from other pachycephalosaurians, but themselves as well. Three species have been named: Spherothallus, Goodwinii, Buchholzii, and Edmontonensis. A brand new paper sought to analyze, organize, and better understand the way these animals grew, and whether they all really belonged to their own species, or if they are all bones that belong to the same type of animal. To do this, they used morphometrics, a technique which involves tracking the major points on the skull digitally. They used histology, a technique involving looking at and describing the characteristics of the bone under a microscope slide after slicing the bone into slide-worthy chips. Finally, they used phylogenetic analyses through the computer to relatively accurately place all three known species and all specimens in a family tree. The ontogenetic assessment of the fossils, or figuring out what characteristics of the bones change as the animal ages, found that all the specimens of the Buchholzii species confirm the previously observed changes of the animal as it grew. The dome gets bigger and more solid as the animal aged. Their phylogeny found that all three species were valid, and that the Edmontonensis and Buchholzii species were grouped together with the Goodwinii species as a sister to that group. Thai spinosaurs. A team of paleontologists including Adun Samathi, P. Martin Sander, and Fornfin Chanthasit described a bunch of dinosaur tail bones which were found at Phu Vyang Mountain, Thailand. These vertebrae were found to most closely resemble those of Baryonyx, and it nested with the Spinosaurids. These remains have been referred to as a Phu Vyang Spinosaurid B, but are too fragmentary for the authors to fully name them. There is another spinosaurid known from Thailand, that being Siamosaurus. The authors of this new study suggest that it is possible these new spinosaurid fossils, those of Fuvian spinosaurid B, may belong to Siamosaurus. Siamosaurus itself is known from even less remains than this Fuvian spinosaur, but together, it may help to piece together what kind of animal Siamosaurus is. With the new material, the authors decided to re-review another possible spinosaur, Camarillosaurus, from Spain. Their analysis found that Camarillosaurus and Fuvian spinosaurid B may be closely related due to some shared characteristics. If Camarillosaurus isn't a spinosaur, then it may be some form of megalosauroid, which the spinosaurids are derived from. The new description here of a possible second spinosaur in Thailand adds evidence to the idea that multiple spinosaurs living in the same region and time is common for Cretaceous ecosystems. This means that the many spinosaurs of North Africa and Europe make some sense. Freshwater sea monsters? James Campbell, Mark Mitchell, Michael Ryan, and Jason Anderson published a paper on the trunk and partial flippers of a freshwater plesiosaur. They named it Fluvionectes sloanae from a specimen collected from freshwater rock deposits from Alberta, Canada. Plesiosaur remains have been found in this area and from freshwater deposits for almost 100 years, but have never been complete enough to name or fully describe. Therefore, little attention has been paid to them. All the known plesiosaur remains from this area may belong to this new Fluvionectes, but are just too fragmentary to give a good identity to at this time.
Our first news study came February 15th, following a study conducted on possible underlying patterns in caudal or tail vertebrae length and variation. The paper had found that there was no consistent relationship between tail length from the sacrum, or the part of the vertebra that fused to form part of the hip, to the end of the tail. This would indicate that the length of the tail isn't universally evolved, as each case for when the tail is shortened or lengthened, it only helps to serve the needs of the type of dinosaur, such as the long whip-like tails of the platykids serving in defense, or the tail of Carnotaurus being made so that the tail muscles could anchor deeply to assist in fast locomotion. The second story came out on February 17th, which covers the oldest genomic survey ever done, using three mammoth specimens which are over a million years old. The genomic study resulted in a discovery that there were two distinct lineages of mammoths in Siberia around the early Pleistocene. One of these lineages gave rise to the classic woolly mammoths that would occupy much of northern Russia and Europe, while the other represented a completely new lineage that was ancestral to the mammoths that would colonize North America from the land bridge that would have connected Russia with Alaska. The Columbian mammoth, a North American staple, was also found to be a sort of hybridization between the two lineages, which gave us some very thoughtful insight on mammoth speciation. Published on the same day was another find, this time from the land down under, the oldest skink find being around 25 million years old. Named Progernia, this lizard boy shared its environment of the Nambia beds with different kinds of fish, alongside different forms of waterfowl, platypuses, possums, and other carnivorous marsupials. This find is important as it helps give clues to how the group arrived and radiated in Australia, and gave rise to familiar members today such as the blue-tongued skink. Last for the month of February was the discovery of what is so far the oldest member of the titanosaurs, the group of sauropods that gave rise to the largest land animals that have ever existed, such as Dreadnoughtus and Argentinosaurus, alongside the smallest of the sauropods, such as Magyarosaurus, the dwarf from Romania that got up to lengths of 6 meters or about 20 feet. Named Ninja Titan, this long neck was about 20 meters long or 60 feet, and was discovered in the Baja Colorada formation in Patagonia, aged at 140 million years ago. This discovery was key in understanding titanosaur evolution and speciation, as it showed that the titanosaurs had originally originated in South America, and that from here, they started to grow big into the early Cretaceous, and by the time of the late Cretaceous, they became some of the largest animals that have ever walked the earth.
As is well known, the radiation of archosaur-morph reptiles in the Triassic period produced an unprecedented collection of diverse forms with a mix of varied body sizes and ecologies. Some were unique to the Triassic, although some body plans would later be converged upon by later members of their groups. One of the most striking examples of this was with the genus Triopticus, which possessed a dome head that would be later seen in the Pachycephalosaurus dinosaurs. Said cranial anatomy has now also been recognised with a second described genus from our Upper Triassic deposits in present-day India. This new taxon was named Cranosaura cuttigi, which was likely to be the sister taxa of Triopticus based on the presence of a greatly expanded skull roof with a deep dorsal opening through the dome, as well as other defining features. Said domes were only about 9 centimetres long, so the animals themselves weren't all that big. The etymology of the genus name comes from the Greek word kranos, meaning helmet, and saura, lizard or reptile, with the specific name honouring T.S. Cussey, who discovered the material back in the 90s. For now at least, little is known of Cranosaura, as they are only represented by the thick, near-solid dome. And with only 2 specimens being known of, there is still a lot of guesswork involved, but they were nonetheless very fascinating animals. The study of audition in fossil hominins is of great interest to anthropologists, given its relationship with intraspecific vocal communication and the potential results which can be gleaned from it. Comparatively less is known about the hearing abilities of Neanderthals when compared to Homo sapiens, and this means that for the longest time, little of their capabilities were understood. A study that relies on computerized tomography scans and a comprehensive model from the field of auditory managed to establish a sound power transmission through the ulcer and middle ear, and then calculated the occupied bandwidth in Neanderthals. The occupied bandwidth, for those who don't know, relates to the efficiency of the vocal communication system of a species, with a larger bandwidth allowing for a larger number of easily distinguishable acoustic signals to be used in vocalization, boosting its efficiency. The results of the study found that the auditory capacities in Neanderthals did not differ too much from those in modern humans. Notably, the occupied bandwidth in Neanderthals extended towards frequencies that primarily involved consonant production, suggesting that this may have been an important component of their vocal communication, making them very similar to us and our capabilities. While much is still to be understood, the results of this paper, coupled with recent discoveries indicating symbolic behaviours, reinforces the idea that the Neanderthals possessed a type of human language, and one that was just as complex and efficient as us. As seen on the channel before, the fauna of dinosaurs and other vertebrates that inhabited late Cretaceous Europe were quite peculiar. Europe during the Cretaceous consisted of an archipelago, with many of the animals found in the region during this time being affected by their insular habitats that resulted in a great range of strange body plans and sizes. While fragmentary, a newly described theropod, specifically a troodontid from Spain, represents the first reported from Europe, dating within 200,000 years of the mass extinction which would eventually wipe them out. Named Tomorrow in Spiratus, while only being known from a second metatarsal, studies of the interior of the bone have shown that it was a subadult, and that it was uniquely fast-growing. According to the bone histology, these animals had a growth pattern in which it grew rapidly in early ontogeny and then attained its subadult size quickly. This growth rate was much quicker when compared to other non-avian theropods, but similar to extant paleognathid birds, indicating their close relation to them and giving paleontologists an interesting look into the history of a newly described animal.
Hello everyone, I'm Omega from Omega Pictures, and we're excited to bring you the next chapter in Paleo Rewind 2021. 2021 was certainly an interesting year for paleontology, with some of the most fascinating discoveries being published in the midst of the current pandemic. And today, we are happy to share with you some of those discoveries from the latter half of March 2021. So, let's go ahead and dive in. Ankylosaur, use dig! 2021 was certainly a big year for ankylosaurs, from possibly the earliest known ankylosaur ever found, to tarsia illustrating how ankylosaurs use their clubs on not just predators, but each other, to even a new species of Chilean anky with an axe for a tail. And it all kicked off on March 18th, 2021. This day marks the publication of a large, burrowing ankylosaur. Ankylosaurus digging certainly isn't new, as Pinacosaurus has been found to live in burrows, and even the largest of them all, Ankylosaurus, was thought to have used its snout for sifting through soil. However, This is the first time that large, burrowing adaptations were recorded in a large ankylosaur. Not just digging, but burrowing. Although, burrowing might be a strong word. This unnamed species was discovered in what is now Mongolia, and described from an incredibly articulated specimen, having preserved a large portion of the skeleton, the forelimbs in particular, showing signs of adaptations for digging through soft substrate. Furthermore, the location and preservation details of the skeleton suggested that the animal lived in a fairly arid environment, which may have helped give rise to said digging adaptations, especially in an environment with soft substrate such as sand. Based on the resting position the fossil was found in, it was hypothesized that the animal would dig shallow pits in the sand to rest in, which could have acted as defense against predators, keeping its soft underbelly under the sand and its sharp, spiky armor on the surface. Interestingly enough, though, this ankylosaur also shares several traits with Cycania, including flank spikes, extra vertebrae, and it was even found in the same formation, indicating some relation between the two, which is poetic considering that the anime Dinosaur King had a Cycania with the earth element. Even more poetic is the fact that there's an episode with an actual burrowing ankylosaurus. Life really does imitate art. Macrops to meme. Pterosaurs, as we know them, are by far some of the most successful creatures ever to take to the air, coming in all sorts of shapes and sizes. However, the standout chap of them all was described on March 31st, 2021, revealing a shiny new star for paleontology. A new species of pterosaur was described, called Cynomacrops, and a uranathid pterosaur from China. Its name means Big Eyes of China, and for good reason. Uranathids were small, bat-like pterosaurs with gigantic eyes and large mouths. This pterosaur was described from an incredibly complete specimen, with missing portions leaving impressions as to where we can fill in the gaps. It's thanks to this articulation that scientists were able to reanalyze and reassess the family in Uranathidae's placement in the pterosaur family tree, concluding that Uranathids were far more derived or advanced than previously interpreted, placed closer in relation to the likes of Rhamphorhynchids and Scraphognathids. And, thanks to its equally famous relative, Uranathus, we have a pretty good idea of what Cynomacrops look like, and from the looks of it, these little guys were pretty adorable. This adorable appearance is part of the reason why Cynomacrops became such a breakout star in paleontology. Having caught the attention of streamers and ARC players, Cynomacrops wasted no time in flying into the mainstream, with its appearance in ARC Survival Evolved. By fan vote, no less. Just goes to show, you don't have to be the biggest or the scariest to be a prehistoric icon.
Oh, hello, and welcome to Paleo Rewind for April 2021. My name is Jimmy, and this is Poe. And no matter how wild and uncertain the past year has been, at least dinosaurs will always be awesome. Once again, we've joined forces with 23 of your favorite paleo YouTubers to bring you the best of the beasts for the year. Now, hopefully, you've just come from a Mega Studios video covering the second half of March 2021. If you haven't seen it yet, truly, it was a fantastic month for ankylosaurs. And since this whole year has rushed by faster than a loose velociraptor in a Florida backyard, we're stoked to bring you some of the most awesome discoveries for the month of April. Kicking off April 1st with fascinating fossil finds that are more ferocious than foolish, in late Cretaceous Patagonia, some of the most diverse and abundant groups of theropod dinosaurs roaming the plains were the abelosaurs. These short-armed, horned-up tooth machines were found in South America, Africa, and India, and included over a dozen varieties like the Indosaurus and the cannibalistic Majungasaurus, and the classic meat-eating bull, Carnotaurus. On April 1st, we added one more. This is the one who brings great fear. also known as Leucalcon aleocranianus, also known as...
We've got new things like Leucalcon, which means the one who causes great fear.
That's not just another Culkin kid.
Exactly.
there is a Culkin who is called Leucalcon.
Yeah.
He's the fourth youngest, who's always charging up a big bar bill and then just taking off.
Its species name translates to the unusual skull, which is right, because in addition to having more openings in its skull for blood vessels and nerves, it also had an air-filled middle ear sinus cavity, which hasn't really been seen in any other abelosaurs. And the fact that Leucalcon and so many other large theropods like it lived in the same area at the same time has scientists curious about whether they competed for the same types of prey. Leucalcon wasn't the only new dinosaur discovered this month. There were several. We had two new duck-billed dinosaurs, like Ornithops incantatus in Late Cretaceous New Mexico and Yamatosaurus from Late Cretaceous Japan. We also welcome the discovery of Chile's third dinosaur ever, a colossal titanosaur named Aracar Licanante, which means the bones of the Atacama in Kunza, the language of the local indigenous tribes. To quote Charles Darwin, or maybe it was Vin Diesel, you don't need competition when you've got family. Tyrannosaurs are some of the most popular and recognizable animals of all time. Kids and adults, and even adults who don't pay much attention to paleontology, can easily point at a T-Rex. The only thing that could make the Tyrant King more formidable is if there were more of them. A bone bed of 4 or 5 tyrannosaurs was uncovered this month in the Kaiparowitz Formation of northern Utah. Now, our friend Steven from Your Dinosaurs Are Wrong will cover the story of the bone bed of these monstrous murderers, so I'm not going to talk about it. So make sure you check out the YDAW channel at this jump right here. Oh, but I really want to talk about it, though. No, it's fine. It's fine. But it's so cool, though. You know what? Go watch Steven's video and then come back. You won't be disappointed. Go check out what he's done. It's really incredible to see it. We've never made it a secret that even though we love dinosaurs, their fossilized neighbors, the marine reptiles, are pretty awesome too. Catherine is particularly fond of mosasaurs, so you can imagine how stoked she was when a new discovery this month revealed a very peculiar behavior in these incredible lizards of the interior seaway. Now, we'll often think of mosasaurs as being massive super predators of the ocean, and scenes like this don't hurt. But did they always spend their time in the salt water? Well, a new study released this month by Leah Taylor, Rebecca Manzoni, Selena Suarez, and more examined the rich oxygen isotopes in the tooth enamel of several mosasaur specimens. Now, because of the density of salt and other minerals in ocean water, the amount of oxygen in a given environment is less than saltwater environments than in freshwater. Which makes sense. If I have two equal amounts of water, and one of them also has a bunch of minerals and salts and other things dissolved into it, then there's not enough room for the exact same amount of oxygen in that amount of water. It's a small difference, but it's significant. And it shows up in the tooth enamel of these mosasaurs. Examining the tooth enamel of two different species, like Platycarpus tympanicus and Cladastes propython, particular favorite of mine, it becomes clear to see through lines of arrested growth that these animals would actually travel from their salty domains to freshwater estuaries about every other week. Now, this is not actually uncommon. We see the same thing happening today as an osmoregulatory function of living sea snakes, which leave the ocean and travel into freshwater to drink up some of the good stuff. Can we jump back a quick second? Because I'm not done with the Tyrannopac stuff just yet, okay? Because just 2 days later, a completely separate study released in the Journal of Vertebrate Paleontology examined the full trackways through the Wapiti Formation of Alberta, Canada, and measured the way Tyrannosaur footprints changed as they grew up. From baby's first stomps to shuffling around the Late Cretaceous shopping mall at 7 o'clock in the morning, the study by Enriquez et al. Shows that as they grew heavier and less agile, Tyrannosaurs shifted their body weight from their toes to their heels. Now, these tracks likely belong to a group of Albertosaurus or Diplodocus, and further adds evidence to the shifting perspective of Tyrannosaurs as lone, opportunistic hunters.
because they lived in groups together. They were pack hunters. It's, go see Steven's video, please. Go check out his stuff and come back. Now, our last story for this month's Rewind takes us back into the maw of Tyrannosaurus rex, with a study presented in the Experimental Biology Convention of the American Association for Anatomy. In this practical experiment, John Fortner was able to build computer models of T-Rex jaws from CT scans and 3D photogrammetry and demonstrate for the first time just how a Tyrannosaurus bit into its prey. Tyrannosaurus chomped through bone by keeping a joint in the lower jaw steady, like an alligator, rather than flexible like snakes. Specialized bones that cross the joint stiffen the lower jaw. Now, in the complex computer models developed by Fortner, the density of bone, the strength of the muscles, and that world-famous bite force calculate together to show just how much strain the jaws undergo during a chomp. Now, by shifting where the jaw actually hinges, Fortner determined that the bones running along the top of the joint keep the lower jaw in place, dispersing that bite force across the whole jaw and ensuring that T-Rex doesn't bite through its own face. That's pretty awesome, right?
Hi, we're participating in EDGE's Paleo Rewind again, and we took the second half of April. Hopefully you're coming here from the April Part 1 video at Dinosaurs Will Always Be Awesome. If not, there's a link in the description. In the Grand Staircase Escalante National Monument in southern Utah is a site awesomely called the Rainbows and Unicorns Quarry, so named because it has abundant, diverse remains from a variety of animals from the Campanian stage of the Late Cretaceous. In it, workers found four or five mostly complete individuals of a large tyrannosaurid called Teratophonius. These specimens range in size and age from juvenile to large adult, but the remains are disarticulated. That's because it appears they were buried completely in a lake, but then varying water levels uncovered and reburied the bones, but didn't carry them away. For example, the ribs are still there, even though those should get washed away first. So this isn't a time-averaged aggregation. These animals all died at the same time. Why? There's evidence of a low-intensity, slow-moving fire at the site, but that's not the kind of fire that can kill multiple tyrannosaurids. The authors couldn't rule out poisoning, but even cyanobacterial neurotoxicosis couldn't drop five tyrannosaurids right next to each other. It takes a while for poisons to act. They wouldn't be clustered together like they are. Were they then forced together by a catastrophe, like what we saw with Allosaurus at the Cleveland Lloyd Dinosaur Quarry? Probably not. The rock is not suggestive of there having been a drought. So, by process of elimination, it appears that these animals all died in a flood. More importantly, since these were not artificially pushed together in life or in death, we have a signal of a mixed-age group of tyrannosaurids living together. These are Teratophonius living as a family group or maybe as a cooperative hunting group. Taken together with similar finds for other taxa, including a track site from the Wapiti Formation that's going to be important in the next paper, it appears that right across Laramidia, we have tyrannosaurids from different times, places, and clades all living gregariously in some way. We had a paper modeling the locomotion of Tyrannosaurus rex, and they approached the topic in a clever way. Traditionally, modeling dinosaur locomotion, you start with the legs and work your way up, and you treat the tail more or less as a balancing rod. These authors treated the tail as a springy component and worked forward. They specifically looked at Trix the T-Rex because that specimen preserves the ligament scars between the vertebra of the tail, and as we have often pointed out, dinosaurs held their tails horizontally straight out, not dragging them. That passive suspension can store energy, and the dinosaur can release that energy whenever it takes a step because the tail muscles are pulling the leg back. The common analogy for this kind of thing, natural and resonant frequencies, is when you're on a swing and you're pumping your legs to keep going. If the T-Rex walking is the swing swinging, then the tail releasing its energy is you extending your legs at the right moment to propel you. If you do it at the wrong time, it's not going to do as much. Therefore, if you can model how frequently the tail bobs up and down, based on the stiffness of the segments and some math I won't pretend to understand, that gives you the timing of Tyrannosaurus's steps. For Trix, this happens every 1.52 seconds. That's our time, but how do we get distance? Well, we use that track site from the Wapiti Formation, scaled so that the footprints are the size of Trix's feet, and that gives us a step length of 1.94 meters. That works out to 4.6 kilometers per hour or 2.9 miles per hour. That may seem slow. It is in fact slower than the average human walking pace, but I'll point out that that is not top speed, that much less running speed. This is the preferred walking speed, just getting around as efficiently as possible. More importantly, because this method of modeling relies on a different set of assumptions than other approaches, it can be used as an independent line of evidence for checking results of those models. We got a description of some preserved skin from a Diplodocus in the Mother's Day Quarry in Montana. This is from the Morrison Formation, the Cameridian stage of the late Jurassic. Not a skin impression, this is the actual skin. It's a carbonaceous film preserving 3D relief of the scales as they existed in life. The authors think this was a small, young Diplodocus for a couple of reasons. All of the scales are small. The small scales can occur on large dinosaurs, but other Diplodocid samples we have are several times larger. The individual scales are several times larger than what we see here. And from this same quarry, we have isolated bones from little Diplodocus. We have the smallest skull we've ever found from a Diplodocus. If you look at a figure of the sample, there's a rib from a small Diplodocus running right through the sample, though that might not actually be from the same animal as the skin. If we had a trace this size off of an adult, we would expect just one type of scales to be represented, but from a little guy, more areas of the body are represented on, you know, a few square feet. So much so that the authors think this was actually from a transitional area of the body, like where the belly transitions up into the back or where the neck meets the shoulder, something like that. There are small polygonal and pebble scales on what could have been the ventral part of the animal, that's the belly. There's also little isolated patches that were probably originally connected to the rest of the scrap. There's then a sharp border of mostly larger rectangular scales, which in one place appear to arch around the base of a limb, in which case it was a small limb, something like 10 centimeters wide at its base. Further up, these give way to large polygonal and globular scales, with a few even larger ornamental ovoid and dome-shaped scales. Now, those ornamental scales all point the same way and interrupt the polygonal pavement, so those might be ornamenting the top of the animal, like in living reptiles. In 1992, Gerkas reported conical spines associated with a Diplodocid tail. These ovoid scales might be a variation of those, or even just a juvenile morph, like as the animal grew, they became taller. We don't know. But it would appear that Diplodocus had a variety of scales covering different parts of its body. A bunch of workers came together to look at the inner ears of archosaurs and their relatives, both living and extinct. And they found that the way we were using them to interpret the behavior of these animals was not great. The traditional view of these semicircular canals, is what they're called, is that in pterosaurs and birds, the size and shape is an adaptation for flight, whereas in crocodiles and lepidosaurs and turtles, the size and shape is the ancestral reptilian condition. Put that in quotes because birds are reptiles. Bird-like semicircular canals, which we should probably call pterosaur-like since they did it first, but they show up in modern flightless birds as well as dinosaurs that are near birds but are not themselves able to fly. The authors think that it was actually the need for visual acuity and gaze stabilization and possibly the ability to run around that was driving semicircular canals to take on these shapes, not flight itself. As for crocodiles, it turns out crocs actually convergently evolved this shape of inner ear alongside lepidosaurs and turtles. We actually don't exactly know what the ancestral sauropsid or archosaur semicircular canals looked like. The modern size and shape is also not directly correlated with aquatic or semi-aquatic behavior. It's actually just a result of their skulls flattening. Overall, this paper casts doubt on the practice of using the semicircular canals to infer behavior and ecology of extinct animals, which we have a tendency to do. For example, there's these two stem archosaurs, Triopticus and Trilophosaurus, which both have pretty bird-like semicircular canals, which we would ordinarily, phylogenetically, expect to mean that they're running animals, they're cursorial. both of these animals seemingly had sprawling limbs. One of them might have been a climber, but neither were runners. All of which is to say, semicircular canals are really interesting phylogenetically. There is definitely a deep split within Archosaura morpha, but using them to infer behavior and ecology is somewhat fraught. I'm also going to do a quick run through of some discoveries that we don't have time to get into in depth. Workers found a large raven skull from a Pleistocene cave in Liaoning, China. This is the first clear record of the common raven lineage in that time and place. Also from Liaoning, this time from the late Cretaceous, we got a juvenile Eornith bird. Now, unlike in juvenile Enantornis, this juvenile's arms were shorter than its legs and got relatively longer as they grew up. Dinosuchus is a famous giant crocodilian from the late Cretaceous of North America, and we have a new specimen from New Mexico. It could be as much as 2 million years older than the earliest Dinosuchus we'd found before this. We got a detailed description of Unenlagia, the perave from late Cretaceous of Patagonia. This corroborates that rather than dromaeosaurids proper, Unenlagians were more derived stem avialans. Workers described a new hadrosaurid from the end of the Cretaceous in Japan, Yamatosaurus. It looks more or less like a little Edmontosaurus, despite being much more basal. We got verification that some teeth from the Upper Cretaceous of Patagonia are Carcharodontosaurian, but all of the later occurring teeth in the paper are Abelosaurid. This supports the idea that there was a turnover from Carcharodontosaurus to Abelosaurus at the end of the Turonian. A species of Titanosaur from the late Cretaceous of Brazil, previously called Aeolosaurus maximus, has been split off into its own genus, Artiodactylan. This is a somewhat more basal animal than its Argentinian relative. Another sauropod, Jara titanus, from the late Cretaceous of Uzbekistan, was reevaluated. It was previously considered a Rabachisaurid, but here it's recovered as a Titanosaur, potentially a relative of the Loncosaurs. That will about do it for April.
Welcome to the month of May. If you're following along with the Paleo Rewind 2021 videos as they come out, you've just come from Dinosaurs Will Always Be Awesome and Your Dinosaurs Are Wrongs videos for April. Make sure you go check out my introduction video for Paleo Rewind 2021 to get the scoop on how it works this year. Garfield comes home. 11 to 5 million years ago, during a stretch of time referred to as the late Miocene, a giant saber-toothed felid stalked through the jungles, forests, and plains of Africa and Eurasia. It's been given the name Machairidus, and over the 188 years since its description, plenty of species of similarly large saber-toothed fossils have been thrown into the Machairidus genus. May saw the publication of the description of another set of felid fossils from Idaho, which the authors identified as belonging to a North American species of the Machairidus. The new species was named Machairidus lahayishibup, that species name coming from the old Cayuse words lahayus for ancient and hupup for wildcat. The bones are relatively fragmentary, consisting only of some skull fragments, a partial funny bone, and an ankle bone. They were found some time ago and were sitting in the collections of the Idaho Museum of Natural History, before someone got the time to take a second gander and get to the bottom of what they were. These remains mean that giant smilodon-like saber-toothed cats existed well before Smilodon itself, and that they may have originated in North America before spreading to Eurasia and Africa, or giant saber-toothed cats independently evolved large body size and huge fangs across the continents. Madagascar has weird turtles too. Madagascar is currently home to some of the most unusual and ancient animals alive. It's been separated from mainland Africa since the time of the dinosaurs, and has had unusual and ancient animals on its surface for just as long. New, completely bizarre fossils found nowhere else are found here all the time. A brand new one was published in May as Sahonachiles melakavava. It's a bizarre suction-feeding side-necked turtle from the late Cretaceous. It's known from a single specimen that's basically the entire skeleton. Turtle shells are easy to fossilize due to their boxy shape and hard bony structure, but most of the time the rest of the skeleton falls out and erodes away before someone can get to unearthing the fossil. So this nearly complete turtle skeleton adds a lot of information as to what kind of turtle it was. The skull was deep and the jaws were structured in such a way that the only solid interpretation of their use was for suction feeding, that being the technique in which the animal opens its mouth super fast and sucks, and the negative water pressure forces any prey items near the mouth to be engulfed lickety-split. This is weird because this type of feeding technique is unknown in most turtles, and has appeared only recently in some modern side-neck turtles, the soft shells, and the mata-mata. Earlier relatives of this new turtle probably didn't have this adaptation, and then it convergently evolved while in isolation in Madagascar for sucking down freshwater creepy crawlies. Italian mollusk-sucking lizard whales. In 1993, a bone bed of giant ichthyosaurs were found in a quarry of Middle Triassic-aged rocks outside of the small town of Lombardy, Italy. It took about 3 years to prepare the multiple skeletons and describe them as Bisonosaurus leptorhynchus. They weren't the largest, but were still pretty big, with some up to 8 meters, 26 feet. They didn't have any dorsal fins or tail flippers like most ichthyosaurs, and were rather whale-like, with a small skull tipped in a long, very thin, pointy snoot bristling with thin, pointy teeth. A new paper published in May added 5 new specimens to the genus. They revised the list of characteristics used to define Bisonosaurus. These new characteristics were found in another ichthyosaur, Mycotocephalus, and is therefore added into the Bisonosaurus group. Thanks to the preserved stomach contents and skull characteristics of close relatives, plus the skull characteristics and stomach content preserved in Bisonosaurus, the researchers hypothesized these guys were soft prey specialists. They had the long, pointy teeth usually used to puncture and hold on to small fish and cephalopods, and had the hydrodynamic sword snout to do so. These guys were not apex predators. Tiny single-clawed desert runner was earliest nocturnal hunter. For most of the history of paleontology, the best way to look into the lives of extinct animals was the rare fossils which preserved bits of soft tissues or behaviors, like footprints. As time has progressed, new technologies have provided researchers with a whole bunch of new ways to reanalyze old specimens and new specimens alike. Instead of just looking at the outside of fossils or destroying them to look inside, scientists can throw the sucker in an X-ray machine or CT scanner and get the good bits of the inside without cracking it open with a rock saw or hammer. Larry Whitmer and his lab specialize in looking inside bones, particularly skulls, to get a better understanding of the operations of many extinct organisms. Previous studies have looked at three-dimensionally preserved inner ears and found clear patterns between the inner ear and complex body movements, like flight. A new study, published in May, decided to look at inner ears and scleral rings to look for any patterns between these bones and nocturnality. Just FYI, scleral rings are a ring of bony squares that rest within the eyes of non-avian and avian dinosaurs for structural support. They analyzed the scans of multiple theropod dinosaurs, including a bunch of modern nocturnal dinosaurs, owls and nightbirds, as well as extinct dinosaurs, Tyrannosaurus, Dromaeosaurus, Shuvuya, and more. The lagina is an organ within the inner ear that helps to process incoming sound information. Nocturnal animals, like the barn owls they looked at, have very long lagina. In fact, owls have the longest lagina of any bird. They have good night vision, but can also hunt in complete darkness with just their hearing. Big eyes trend towards nocturnality, and big laginas trend towards nocturnality too. The eyes of Tyrannosaurus and Dromaeosaurus were optimized for daytime vision, but they also had large laginas for better than average hearing. This probably means they were alright at moving around at night, but were more likely to have been more active during the day. Shuvuya, on the other hand, had a lagina the same size as the owls. They also had some of the largest pupils proportionally of any known avian or non-avian dinosaur. This means that not only could this little pointy-snouted, single-clawed, long-legged dinosaur hear incredibly well, but it could also see incredibly well. This is basically the first, all but confirmed, nocturnal, non-avian dinosaur on record. Pelecanimimus gets some attention. 1993 saw the discovery of the front half of the skeleton of an ostrich-like theropod dinosaur from early Cretaceous Spain. It was named Pelecanimimus a year later, and is considered an early diverging member of the ostrich dinosaur family, with tiny little teeth in its long, pointy, pelican-like beak. Despite its importance to the understanding of Ornithomimosaurian evolution and its bizarre anatomy, the whole specimen was never rigorously described, until now. A new paper thoroughly discusses each and every body part in detail. They found that it diverged early from the Ornithomimosauria, but forms a unique clade alongside Harpimimus shenshausaurus and the rest of the advanced Ornithomimosaurs, but excludes all other primitive forms. Deep sea mosasaurs? Yet another mosasaur was published this year. It goes by the name of Pleurodens serpentis and comes from Maastrichtian-aged rocks of the latest Cretaceous of Morocco. It was a big boy at about 8 meters, 26 feet. Overall, it didn't differ that much in looks from most mosasaurs to the untrained eye. However, it did have much smaller eye sockets than most mosasaurs, which means it wasn't relying on eyesight as much. The jaws were lined with equally spaced sensory holes that may have allowed the beast to sense minute changes in water pressure to search for prey. From these characteristics and many more, the authors suggest it may have hunted in low-light conditions by sensing its way around rather than just seeing. This new mosasaur also brings up the list of late Cretaceous Moroccan mosasaurs to 13. That means this place was positively teeming with mosasaurs that took to all sorts of ecological positions. Mosasaurs were not declining by the end of the Cretaceous. If that extinction hadn't occurred, they would have continued unabated. New Big Nose Horn Face. A new centrosaurine ceratopsian was named Menephiceratops coelii from fossils uncovered all the way back in 1996. The fossils come from the Cretaceous rocks of the Menifee Formation of northwestern New Mexico. This makes it the oldest known member of the centrosaur lineage of the horned dinosaurs. The centrosaurs being the group with the generally smaller frills, bigger frill ornaments, bigger nose horns, and bigger noses. The critter is most closely related to the long-horned Nasutoceratops, the fragmentary Crittenden ceratops, and the Mexican Yehuicao ceratops. It likely would have had a deep schnoz, no nose horns, and had two short forward-pointing brow horns and a relatively boring squared-off frill. Besides that, the rest of it probably looked relatively similar to Nasutoceratops. It is unusual for where and when its fossils were from, it being from the south of North America and the oldest known centrosaur suggests these horned dinosaurs may have evolved down south and then spread to the north before becoming extinct in the south. Oldest modern mammal trackway from the middle of nowhere, Wyoming. A pair of researchers from Texas A&M Natural Resources Institute have described a 1,031-meter, 3,385-foot-long trackway from Paleocene, Wyoming. These tracks were laid down in what was once a brackish water lagoon by two species of large mammal. The largest tracks belong to what might be a five-toed pantodont, a group of mammals that were some of the first to take on large body sizes right after the non-avian dinosaurs got clocked by the asteroid. Some more like the ground sloths of recent times, others like trunkless tapirs, and more were like nothing we have alive today. The smaller tracks were made by a four-toed mammal of unknown affinity. This is the largest accumulation of Paleocene mammal tracks in the world, and only the fourth of its kind. Two sets of mammal tracks from this time come from Canada and one from Norway.
Hello there, wary traveler. I see you've made it this far into Paleo Rewind 2021. Who am I, you might ask? All right, I need to stop it. Greetings, hello, ladies and gentlemen. It's David, aka Spinadude, back for another Paleo Rewind. Big thanks to Edge for asking me to be a part of this again. And let's just dive into the second half of May 2021, because we've got some pretty epic stuff to cover. We're kicking things off with a bit of a banger here. A 180 million year old fossil from the early Jurassic seems to have captured three levels of an ancient food chain at work. Uncovered from an abandoned quarry in Germany, the Slabo rock contains the decapod Proerion, which is entangled in the tentacles of the belemnite Pelasotuthis, which in turn seems to have evidence of predation damage from a larger vertebrate predator, possibly the early Jurassic shark Hybodus. A pretty cool find if you ask me. Makes me wonder if they kept digging if they would have found a pliosaur munching on the shark or something. Imagine if it just kept going layers and layers deeper. Moving right along, North America's earliest known side-necked turtle, dubbed Pleuroshaya appalachius, was unearthed in Texas. The remains date back approximately 96 million years, predating the previous record holder, Paeutemus tibert. Well, what is a side-necked turtle, some of you may be wondering? Unlike other turtles that retract their heads directly into their shells, side-necks bend their necks horizontally against their body and are typically further protected by a large overhanging shell. The group originated down south in Gondwana and began migrating northwards during the early Cretaceous. And so far, Pleuroshaya is the earliest known side neck from North America, dating back to the Cenomanian of the late Cretaceous. Man, I think that's the most times I've ever said neck in one video. In other news, a new study reveals that Eurasian horses diverged from North American horses a million years ago. The Caballine horse lineage, which contains domestic horses, spread into Eurasia about 1 million years ago. And with this first detailed look at horse genetics, it was found that there were at the very least two separate periods where the horses moved back and forth between the continents and interbred. This resulted in Eurasian horses obtaining North American horse DNA, and vice versa. I don't know a whole ton about horses myself, but I thought it was pretty cool that we were able to get this much new information from their genetics. Anywho, remember Adiocetus weltoni? Yeah, me neither. Okay, but just hear me out, this is pretty rad. In a new study on the prehistoric whale, they found holes and grooves on the roof of the animal's mouth that internally connect with a vascular canal, which is very similar to blood vessel patterns in modern-day baleen whales. And since Adiocetus is an evolutionary cousin of today's Mysticetes, or baleen whales, it's most likely that this ancient cetacean sported both baleen and teeth within its jaws, which is pretty wicked. The study provides substantial evidence of a major shift in feeding behavior in these animals, from a more typical carnivorous diet to bulk filter feeding mode. And hey yo, Edge, if you ever decide to make a video on this lad, I have the perfect tagline for you: the toothbrush that bites back. Never mind, whatever, I'll show myself out. Anyway, the first complete egg of an extinct King Island dwarf emu was found. Islands off Australia's coast were once home to three subspecies of the mainland's emu. Sadly, all three of these variants are now extinct, with the King Island being wiped from their island by 1805, with a captive pair in Paris surviving until 1822, the Kangaroo Island variant survived until about 1830, and the Tasmanian until about 1850. We don't know a crazy amount about these birds considering how recently they went extinct, and only a few museum specimens exist worldwide. The first complete egg of the dwarf King Island emu was found on King Island with a skeleton of the animal, and what's most surprising is while King Island emus were nearly half the size of the mainland emu, the egg was of similar size linearly, but less so in mass volume and with a slightly thinner shell. This is an overall very interesting find that helps us learn more about these fascinating island birds that left our planet not too long ago. And our final new discovery from May 2021 is the one you most likely heard of out of this batch.
Introducing the new Lambiosaurine hadrosaur, Tlatalophus galorum. Unearthed in northern Mexico in the 2000s and publicly described just this year, Tlatalophus is the most complete Lambiosaurine found in the entire country. The remains include an exceptionally well-preserved skull, complete with the unique head crest the animal sported about 73 million years ago during the Campanian of the late Cretaceous. While the remains are still being further studied, this is still an amazing discovery for Mexico, and another great example of hadrosaurid head crest diversity.
In the first few days of June, a study was published that described the oldest written documentation of trace fossils, alternatively called ichnofossils. I've talked about these before on this channel. They include dung, footprints, scrape marks, and other signs left behind by animal activities. In this case, the paper describes the work of one Bernard Palissy in 1580, who described a Jurassic-aged rock preserving small burrows that were created by tough little mollusks called pholads. Though the Frenchman did not necessarily know that it was Jurassic in age, that term wouldn't come about until 1829, he did recognize these bores in the rock as being made by ancient creatures that no longer exist, and put his thoughts in writing in a book called Discours Admirable. Despite the recognition, the study does point out that Palissy was not the first person to ponder the ancient past through ichnofossils. Leonardo da Vinci had writings on trace fossils that he came upon in the early 1500s, though he never made those officially published pieces. But even long before him, people around the world have been interested in these signs of the past for tens of thousands of years. From Paleolithic Europeans who collected Miocene-aged bored mollusk shells as decoration and possibly currency, to the indigenous people of Australia, whose folklore includes mentions of dinosaur footprints that are recognized as the traces of unknown giant creatures. Fossil hunting and interpretation is indeed an old practice. While we're here, Australian paleontology set a few records this year, and at least both of the ones I know about happened in early June. You might have seen the first one in press coverage with headlines loudly proclaiming it as Australia's largest dinosaur, accompanied by this lovely artistic reconstruction. And for once, it's not all that hyperbolic. Uncreatively named Australotitan cooperensis, this giant was from a group of sauropod dinosaurs aptly called titanosaurs, and lived during the Cenomanian or Turonian stage of the late Cretaceous, so sometime between about 100 to 90 million years ago. Despite it only just being named this year, the holotype was actually discovered back in 2005 in Queensland, near the town of Erromanga, and hails from the Winton Formation, which is the setting of the new novel Banjo and Swift, which was actually published in late June of this year. As you can see, it's not the most complete skeleton ever found, but for a giant sauropod, especially for a titanosaur which get named every other week based on a neck or backbone, it's actually fairly decent. While it is definitely the largest dinosaur found on the continent, trying to determine its actual dimensions opens up a whole can of worms that the authors clearly didn't want to bother with, since the paper doesn't include any size estimates. The femur alone is about 7 feet long, so what more do you really need to know though? Besides, other dinosaurs evidently didn't hold much reverence for its size anyway, since the remains show that the bones have been stepped on by a group of other, smaller sauropods walking in single file. If they don't care, we don't care. Size is overrated anyway. Moving on. The other new record holder from Down Under is a bit more interesting, and comes in the form of a partial crocodilian skull that was also found in Queensland, though it's much younger than the Winton Formation and hails from either the Pliocene or Pleistocene, so anywhere between 5 to 2 million years ago. The specimen was actually found back in at least the 1870s, when fossil prospectors for the then new Queensland Museum were looking for things to add to the collection, and the croc skull was just one of thousands of remains that were found and thrown into the museum's archives without much study nor any proper data as to where exactly they were discovered, which is why nobody can pinpoint specifically when the animal itself is from. Like with Australotitan, the authors on this study weren't confident enough in the material they had to put a size to the animal in their paper, but they were able to determine that it was a member of the Thomistomines, a family of crocs that today is only represented by the false gharial of Southeast Asia. From this, they were able to estimate a total skull length of about 80 centimeters, 2 feet 7 inches, which puts it on par with the very largest recorded individuals of Australia's known big crocs, the good old salties. Based on this, the authors were willing to state that this animal is the largest crocodilian known from the continent, which along with being the southernmost representative of the Thomistomines and the first of their kind to be found in Australia, earned it the awesome name Gungamarandu Manala, or River Boss with a Head Hole. The discovery of this reptile adds to Australia's already extensive Cenozoic crocodilian diversity, and further suggests that competition among these various armored reptiles was lessened through some degree of niche partitioning, with different species specializing in their own kinds of prey and specific habitats. I'm sure Steve Irwin would have had a field day if all these guys were still around, not to mention the other creatures of the ancient outback. He probably would have also enjoyed the Mesozoic as well, which hosted an entire menagerie of crocodilian diversity all its own, even though dinosaurs, of course, take up most of the spotlight. One of these groups, the late Cretaceous-aged European Allodapasuchids, was the subject of the next study, which majorly re-evaluated the clade as a whole with the novel idea of using the entire body instead of just the heads of these animals to identify distinguishing features between the 10 or so different species. This method redefined the skeletal characteristics of many of the already existing taxa, lumping two formerly unique genera, Agarasuchus and Lohoikosuchus, into Allodapasuchus as their own distinct species, as well as revealing a new species that was named Allodapasuchus iberoamericanus. Looking at all this diversity, you might wonder how all these different reptiles originated. To get some hints of the answer to that question, you have to go back to about 300 million years to the Carboniferous, when giant bugs were jumping and the oxygen was high. In that part of the world that would eventually become the American Midwest, you might find a little lizard-like animal that would eventually be called Anthracodromius longipes, though to locate it you'd have to look up. A study on this critter's feet and claws suggested that it was likely scansorial, showing that while giant arthropods and amphibians were dominating the land at this time, the first reptiles took to the trees. Moving forward to the Permian, you'd find animals like Raranimus dachshankawensis, which is part of a group of animals called therapsids, which us mammals come from. Though it's only known from a single isolated snout from the Qingtaoshan formation of southwestern China, a CT scan of these few remains found enough characteristics to solidify its place among the therapsid family tree as the oldest known member of the group. Going back to the Mesozoic realm, June proved to be a relative boon for new work on hadrosaurs and their biology. There was a trio of new, or at least majorly reassessed species published during these first 2 weeks, each from a different part of the world, but all three living at about the same time in the late Campanian, roughly 75 or so million years ago. A team of Mexican paleontologists described the partial remains of a potentially new large lambiosaur from the Cerro del Pueblo formation in Coahuila, though the fossils were too scrappy for them to directly compare it against other hadrosaurs from the region and give it an actual name, so it's just an indeterminate lambiosaur for now. Over in Spain's Figuerola formation, a new basal hadrosaur called Phylex thoracolossus joins the ranks of the non-hadrosaurid hadrosauroids alongside the newly re-evaluated Chinese species Tanais sinensis, one of the country's first named dinosaurs, which was discovered in Shandong's Wangxi group almost a century ago before becoming a poorly studied wastebasket taxon for decades. As overlooked as they are among dinosaurs, hadrosaurs and their ornithopod relatives are the gift that keeps on giving for dino biology, as evidenced by these next two studies. The first is from a team of German and Swiss researchers who analyzed thousands of fossilized remains of the 145-million-year-old African dinosaur Dicelotosaurus letoburbeki. This relatively small herbivore was found in the Jurassic-aged Tendaguru beds of southeastern Tanzania as part of a large-scale, multi-year fossil hunting expedition mounted by the German Museum für Naturkunde in Berlin and carried out by hundreds of Africans during the height of Germany's violent colonial presence in the region in the early 20th century. By looking at historical notes taken by the German paleontologists overseeing the project, the present-day team were able to study the characteristics of the single site that all known Dicelotosaurus remains were found. They concluded that this bone bed was likely the site of an ancient river choke point, where herds of animals would have had to cross during seasonal migrations, and over the course of perhaps a few years, if not decades, four different mass death events took place, with up to dozens of individuals drowning at a time. This situation is not dissimilar to what happens in the same region today with wildebeest herds, where it isn't uncommon for herds to lose dozens of members of various ages to the chaos caused by panic and the torrent of the river's current. While unfortunate for the animals involved, for paleobiologists, events on this scale provide plenty of data for working out things like growth patterns, life expectancies, and possible social group structures. From these events, we can reasonably infer that Dicelotosaurus at least traveled in multi-aged herds with young and old dinosaurs, all likely living together for at least part of the year, with the oldest individuals being roughly 20 years old and living alongside animals as young as one. The fact that two of the animals had medullary bone, a type of bone female reptiles use to produce calcium for eggshells, also suggests that these migration events might have been motivated by the breeding season, and the herds were moving either to or from their nesting grounds when they encountered this perilous obstacle. So, a lot of really good information here that can provide plenty of info for further study in the future. The second publication looked at the partial remains of a Gobihadros mongoliensis, I'll let you guess where it's from, and was able to determine clear signs of a bone disease called primary calcium pyrophosphate deposition, which is associated with old age. This is significant considering that most dinosaurs that have been found were immature at death, being more or less juveniles or sexually mature adolescents, as opposed to fully mature adults. In addition to layers of excess calcium deposits that would have caused some degree of painful swelling and reduced mobility in its tail and left foot, the animal's remains showed other signs of terminal growth, such as layers of bone growing over and closing off vascular channels that would have otherwise supplied blood and other nutrient-rich fluids to its long bones as it was growing. So not only does this show that this animal was just straight up old, it also overturns the prevailing notion that dinosaurs continued growing throughout their lives, like other reptiles, even in spite of their evident live-fast-die-young lifestyle. One of the authors of this study also published related work a few days prior that further described this type of bone overgrowth in detail and suggested it as a good sign for indicating that an individual dinosaur is in fact old, though for whatever reason, neither study actually referenced the other one. While we're looking at dinosaur skeletal anatomy and what it can tell us about their biology, these next few studies are worth a mention. The first is a paper on juvenile tyrannosaurs, T-Rex specifically, which experimentally measured their bite forces. As everyone knows, adult T-Rex had extremely powerful jaws, but less work has been done on the chomping strength of their younglings. To remedy this, the researchers 3D printed a model tooth out of cobalt and then used a machine to press it into cow bones to see how much pressure was needed for it to replicate the puncture marks that had been found on Edmontosaurus limb bones and the skulls of other juvenile T-Rex. You can read the paper, link in the description, as with all the others, if you want to check out the specifics of their final results, but basically, it was roughly whatever you'd expect. Strong, but not as strong as the adults. The next is an analysis of the South American dromaeosaurs called unenlagines, specifically looking at their vertebral morphology. These unusually long-snouted and short-armed raptors are a more recently discovered group, and so not much has actually been published on their skeletal anatomy, like whether they possessed pneumatized, aka hollow, vertebrae like birds, that would have been filled with a system of air sacs to lighten their skeletons and may have helped them breathe more efficiently. Unsurprisingly, considering that most theropods and sauropods have this trait, the study found that unenlagines did in fact have these openings in their vertebrae, so they weren't unusual in that regard. There isn't necessarily anything groundbreakingly exciting here, but it's always good to have more data points for these sorts of things, as it can help to further flesh out patterns of evolution. In looking at this study, what I personally found more interesting was the fact that alvarosaurs actually lacked pneumatized skeletons, or at least vertebrae. It may or may not have much bearing, but it's a good lead into the next paper that we'll be covering. A joint Argentinian-Chinese team of researchers examined the partial skull and brain case of an unnamed alvarosaurid and compared it to several others in the group from various positions among the family tree of these strange little one-fingered dinosaurs. What the scientists found was that these creatures had enlarged foramen magnum, which is the hole in the back of the skull that the spinal cord runs through. This, combined with other adaptations like a well-defined ear cavity, as also seen in the Mongolian shuvuya, suggests that alvarosaurids had particularly good hearing, able to pick up on low-frequency sounds, and heightened motor control of their head movements. Together with other research published earlier in the year about their tails, it seems like these were some rather specialized, highly dexterous little dinos that might have preyed on colonial insects like termites. The study also had a phylogenetic component, wherein the authors argued that some basal alvarosaurs, specifically Haplochirus, Arun, and Shishugonychus, might be better placed as early ornithomimosaurs due to a number of skull features that they share with creatures like Harpymimus, Pelicanomimus, Shenzhousaurus, and Nguebosaurus, and a lack of other features that they don't share with more derived alvarosaurs like Shuvuya and Mononychus. This reshuffling isn't too surprising, considering that these two groups are sometimes considered as each other's closest relatives, so seeing commonalities among their early members is in no way out of left field. That said, the paper doesn't make any hard suggestions here, it just says that it's a hypothesis that needs more evaluation in future work. And it could just be that these tentatively basal alvarosaurs don't share much similarity with later members of their group, simply because the latter are so specialized. I mean, look at those hands. The tragically ugly specter of the Myanmar amber fossils raised its head again in a couple different publications. If you're unfamiliar, there's a series of gem mining quarries that date to roughly 100 million years ago in Myanmar, and many of the incredible fossils found there are bought from local vendors after being extracted from the earth by laborers, sometimes children, working under duress in extremely dangerous conditions for practically no pay. If that wasn't bad enough, because low-key this kind of thing isn't historically uncommon in paleontology, the study of these fossils might also be directly funding and fueling the ongoing Kachin conflict, with the jade mines a commodity that the two sides involved are fighting over. This issue was brought to light in the wake of the highly publicized 2020 naming of Oculodentavis congrae, which was originally described as a weird toothed bird whose tiny skull got trapped in amber. Aside from the human rights abuses invoked, The study's publication and phylogenetic conclusions came under heavy scrutiny almost immediately, and the June 2021 description of this critter, a new species called Oculodentabis naga, reinforced those long-held criticisms and confirmed these animals as lizards instead of extremely weird birds. Somewhat unsurprisingly, the American Society of Vertebrate Paleontology implored various journals to turn down publications involving these fossils, and the initial paper on Oculodentabis congre was itself retracted in July 2020. But for those that have continued to publish on these fossils for one reason or another in certain journals, it's generally good practice to include an ethics statement that at least acknowledges the acquisition of the amber in question. This paper, which describes two new bird species with some interesting foot anatomy, did not do such a thing, so I won't really say anything more about it here, though there's a link in the description if you want to read more yourself. Moving on to some birds we can talk about, a new species of ancient pelican was described from the sandstone rocks of the Wadi al-Hitan World Heritage Site in Egypt. Named Eopelicanus aegypticus, this single complete leg bone, a right tibiotarsus to be specific, was fairly easily identifiable as the remains of a pelican when it was first dug up in 2008, and dates from the Eocene epoch about 36 million years ago, making it the oldest known member of the pelican family. Apparently the body plan of these goofily charismatic birds is a pretty successful one, considering that they've barely changed it since they first evolved, and I find it weirdly sobering to think that pelicans have been around for longer than a lot of your favorite animal groups of today. Another modern and familiar group that has been around for a long time are the frogs, and a study of them was published that looked at edentulism, or the condition of having no teeth. By charting this condition among over 500 different modern genera and looking at their evolutionary history and relationships with each other, the researchers found that frogs have independently lost their teeth at least 20 different times, with many likely being a response to the diversification of colonial insects like ants and termites, which occurred during the Cretaceous and Paleogene periods. Basically, all these different frog groups said, "We don't need teeth to eat these things," and so they lost them, but then later on, six of their various descendant groups decided, "Actually, teeth might be nice for other things," and so they re-evolved teeth. Because that is how frogs do. While frogs were figuring out their dental plans, their larger reptilian neighbors had other problems to deal with, like the giant space rock that fell from the sky at the end of the Cretaceous and wiped many of them out. This next study used computer simulation models to look at the after effects of the Chicxulub impact, specifically how it affected the cycle of nutrient flow in the ocean, which is a relevant question since the asteroid did slam into the sea near the Yucatan Peninsula in what is now Mexico. You can actually swim through the cave systems that are the remains of the crater. As we know, the thick cloud of dust, soot, and carbon dioxide kicked into the atmosphere by the asteroid blocked out the sun for the first 2 to 3 years post-impact, reducing the ability for any surviving plants to photosynthesize. What the study shows is that this cloud also caused a steep drop in global ocean surface temperatures, going from an estimated average of 21 degrees Celsius to only 7 degrees Celsius in about 5 years, and severely reducing ocean productivity. Ironically though, this cooling of the surface water, plus all the carbon released from the fires of the impact, actually helped kickstart the new ocean cycle. Cold water is denser than warm water, so it sinks while warmer water rises. This process is called convection, and the convection currents brought up nutrients from the deeper water that fueled the growth of certain microorganisms like algae. Now in an environment with plenty of CO2, and supplied with ample available nutrients from the asteroid like iron, oceanic algae began to bounce back, and when the ash cloud cleared enough for photosynthetic activity to reach pre-impact levels, these little lifeforms had a field day. This would have had a number of different effects. Harmful algal blooms released dangerously high levels of toxins, which would have been disastrous for any surviving marine fauna in those regions. The algae would have also released dimethyl sulfide, which helps form clouds and would have prolonged the global cooling for nearly a century, as well as fueling the acid rain showers that would have periodically fallen across the world for the next few decades. This rain, plus all the CO2 and dihydrogen sulfate released into the water by the asteroid strike, would have rapidly dropped the ocean's pH levels by nearly 0.36 units in only a few years. So in summation, for at least the first decade or so, the Earth's oceans would have been a cold, acidic hellscape dominated by red tides, and it would take centuries for life as a whole to recover. But recover it did, and among those survivors, we mammals rose to particular prominence. Returning to Tanzania, there's a region within the East African Rift Valley called Olduvai Gorge, which has preserved and provided plenty of evidence for the rise of our own species. This next publication doesn't directly concern us though, but rather the animals our hominin ancestors lived alongside, and what it can tell us about the ecosystem at the time. The specific fossils are a series of different tracks, all about 1 million years old and produced by a variety of medium to large even-toed hoofed animals. These ancient footprints, two of which were identifiable as waterbuck and antelope tracks, were found in 2019 and are the first ones to have been found in Olduvai Gorge. Their presence and preservation detail indicates that the region was regularly visited by large herbivores due to its at least seasonal availability of fresh water and good grazing grounds, a good habitat for any potential hunter-gathering societies. For our final prehistoric discovery, we move forward a bit in time and further down the continent to another world-renowned paleoarchaeological site, Border Cave in KwaZulu-Natal, South Africa. Located on a cliffside in the Lubombo Mountains, Border Cave is notable for preserving records of countless generations of Homo sapiens, at least some of whom were likely the ancestors of the San people indigenous to the region and lived there for nearly 120,000 years. Among the fossils found here include the partial skeleton of a baby who would have only been about 4 to 6 months old when they died some 74,000 years ago. Conducted by a joint team of South African, Kenyan, and American researchers, the study in question analyzed the internal bone structure of the baby's hip and compared it to modern human babies and toddlers to see if there were any developmental, and thus possibly behavioral, differences between modern humans and our Stone Age predecessors when it comes to when we start learning how to stand and walk. What they found is that this 4 to 6 month old baby had patterns of bone growth and thickness similar to children in the 6 to 12 month age group, which could be interpreted to imply that this child was already trying to at least stand up, if not take a few steps. It could also be reflective of the baby's family members routinely holding them in a standing position that would help strengthen their legs, even if the baby wasn't yet able to stand independently. Either interpretation is adorable, and might also suggest that Stone Age children would have matured slightly faster than modern children, which could make sense since we were still a wilderness living species at the time, and it would be important to be prepared to face the world as early as possible, though the authors note that this conclusion is very tentative since we only have data from one Stone Age individual. As with anything in paleontology and science in general, more will have to be found to make more thorough comparisons and broader analyses, but that doesn't reduce the value that each fossil still provides as a unique window into the past. Windows that, as I mentioned at the beginning, we've been fascinated by and interacted with in one way or another for thousands of years. Is it any wonder why paleontology is so popular and enduring when it's part of our species tradition?
Keenan here over at Tales of Chimera and Illustrated Menagerie. I am a scientific illustrator and fantasy author. Most of my work is set in Chimera, a seed world speculative biology project that features the descendants of many animals extinct on Earth. In today's video, my last for the year, I have the pleasure of being included in the roster for Paleo Rewind, a series hosted by the Expeditioners Discovery Guild Enterprise, or EDGE. If you haven't already, I recommend you begin with Curious Archives and Paleo Analysis in their discussions of the discoveries and studies announced in January of this year. In the previous video in the series, Adasaur discussed major finds in the first half of June in 2021. Today, I will be going over some of the major finds that caught my interest in the later half of the month, with particular emphasis on those which influenced my work on Chimera. A new species of Paraceratherium was described during this time, found in northern China, which had a lot of interesting implications in the wide range and dispersal of this genus, as this new species was closer to those found further west in Asia than the more basal species described in this area. This study, which discussed, among other things, the benefits of being large when dispersing, influenced my inclusion of the Glanos to the eastern continent. Although Paraceratherium is not found in Chimera, the Glanos is a calicothere which, through convergent evolution, is quite similar to this fascinating genus. There were two major announcements of archaic humans that I want to talk about today. Homo longi, based on an impressive skull, was officially named during this time. The authors and many others believe this is finally a type specimen of Denisovans, a lineage of humans famously discovered quite by accident when doing genome sequencing of a finger bone. There's been some pushback by their anthropologists about making this a new species, for reasons I'll get to in a moment. Another study explored the Neshar Ramla Homo, which is an interesting blend of archaic human and Neanderthal features and technology, suggesting a great degree of interaction between the two populations. These two studies influenced Chimera in that I am no longer officially calling Chimerans their own species. Between how much our ancestors and other archaic humans interbred, There's been a lot of doubt in such designations as Neanderthals, Denisovans, Homo heidelbergensis, and others actually being distinct species. As the ancestors of Chimerans diverged from our own ancestors a few hundred thousand years ago, making them more recent than Neanderthals and Denisovans, now Homo longi, if these two are lumped into our own as a subspecies, then Chimerans would logically be a subspecies too. The most influential discovery to Chimera in this time frame was a paper published by Dr. Holtz discussing the difference in predatory theropod diversity during the reign of tyrannosaurs. Compared to such ecosystem as the Morrison Formation, with a wide range of theropods from many clades and sizes coexisting together, where derived tyrannosaurids went, a trend seems to be in reduced predator diversity, particularly in those within 100 and 1,000 pounds. The reason for this is quite simple. Young tyrants filled these niches. By occupying several niches as they grew, tyrannosaurs put pressure on other predators. Since they took many years to grow, yet adults had many young per year, there were perhaps as many as a dozen tyrants of different growth stages for every adult in the given territory. Although this sort of phenomenon no doubt occurred with young of other apex theropods like Allosaurus, the prolonged juvenile stage of tyrants appears to have been enough of a force of pressure that diversity in populations of other predators in this size range was greatly reduced. In Chimere, where Megaraptorans have grown massive and share quite a lot in common with the tyrants before them, this situation is also seen in the ecologies where these predators are dominant. In the conifer rainforests, the most widespread and productive terrestrial ecosystem in the known world, between a quarter and half of the predators in this size range are young centaur, adults of which are the top predator of the ecosystem. There are mammalian predators, other theropods like abelisaurids and dromaeosaurs and more, but the population of juvenile centaur is quite a dominant presence. A twist on this is found in the Housy Prairie, the domain of the Uktan. The Uktan demonstrates prolonged parental care with fewer offspring, often keeping their young and providing food and defense well into their second decade. Since young Uktan are removed from the equation, the predator diversity of the Housy Prairie is much higher, although all still acknowledge the Uktan as king. This context seen in tyrannosaurs may well be a contributing factor to our final topic for this video, the overall decline in dinosaur biodiversity in the 10 million years leading up to the extinction event that wiped out all non-avian dinosaurs on Earth. 6 dinosaur families were examined, predator and prey, and this pattern was seen across the board. Hadrosaur dominance putting pressure on other clades is cited by the authors, but the pressure is put on predators by specializations of the tyrants may well be a factor as well. Whatever the reason, as is so often the case, a perfect storm culminated in the conclusion of the age of dinosaurs, and it seems a reduction in biodiversity, and in turn a reduction in species adaptability, likely made a dominant dinosaurs victims of their own success.